the rule of the modern politics. That's it. Just confuse them, and we'll get their vote.
I think certain academics, especially ones on panels and conferences, also follow that advice.
Because academia is full of politics. Yeah. You have to make things more complicated than they perhaps have to be.
The world is more complicated.
Good. Looking forward to that. Yes.
From the history department and co-convener of the class dismissed working group. And on the theme that Walter Ben Michaels and I have arrived at for this working group, I don't think we could have a better text to consider or a better guest to discuss the text with than Jefferson Cowie and his multi-award-winning book, The Last Days of the Working Class, Social History, Politics, and Pop in the 1970s. There's Walter. I was just invoking it, okay. Jeff is an old and dear friend of mine. He grew up near here in Crystal Lake, just outside the city. Was educated as an undergraduate at Berkeley, and then I encountered him during his graduate years at University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. Since that time, he's really been, I think, he's been in Ithaca teaching in both the history department and the School of Industrial and Labor Relations at Cornell. One of my greatest moments of pride was to see myself cited as an influence on Jeff in his work, where I'm listed alongside James Baldwin, the Clash, and the dead Kennedy. I didn't get a photo, but. And Jeff, as many of you know, in addition to the book that from which we excerpted a couple of chapters for this working group session, he is also the author of another book that had a big impact in American history and labor history circles, Capital Moves, RCA's 70-Year Quest for Cheap Labor, which came out first in 1999 and then was republished as a paperback by the New Press in 2001. And another collection that had considerable reverberation called Beyond the Ruins, an edited collection, Beyond the Ruins, The Meanings of Deindustrialization. Currently, Jeff is working on a collection called Debating Globalization, A Brief History of the World Trade Organization with documents. So Jeff is going to begin our session with some remarks, sort of laying out his larger argument, I think, about class in the 1970s, but still leaving us plenty of time for hopefully a wide-ranging discussion. So Jeff, welcome.
Thanks, Dan. Leanne said he encountered me at UNC. I thought you were gonna say single-handedly molded, but you don't wanna take the heat that's gonna come down here in the latter half of the seminar. And I do encourage heat. I invite a vigorous debate. I realize this is, the title of the book is immodest. It's making a big claim, and I would like to, the title of the book, maybe not the title of this particular talk, that is the 1970s and the last days of the working class. And I want to get out front on what I mean by last days of the working class. What I mean, and I don't know how much people read, I know a couple of chapters were posted, and maybe some of you read it in a seminar or something like that, but the most important thing to keep in mind is I don't mean this in a material sense. In fact, I think it's fairly obvious to anybody who's paying attention that class stratification is increased dramatically since the 1970s. But the sort of tragic irony of our age is that while it's increasing in material ways, ideologically, politically, socially, it's not part of how we imagine ourselves. There's sort of, as I like to say, there's a hole in our civic imagination where the issues of class and inequality belong. I think some of that's changed in the last couple of years, especially since the crash and some of the Occupy movements and things like that, which we can talk about maybe at the end. But I still think that the idea holds. And my hope is, though, that maybe, you know, as I often say, the 70s are the roots of our own time, as I'm saying here. Just like the 30s and 40s, which are the foundation of the post-war era, that that's kind of political and economic structures that emerged in that moment shaped the post-war era. The political and economic structures of the late 70s and early 80s shaped our own time, and maybe things are reshuffling right now, and I think we can begin to think about that. So I'm really talking about the dissolution of an idea. I'm not talking about the end of class. I'm talking about the end of class as an idea, as an ideology, as a place we go to in our minds. So I just want to be very clear on that, because some people have gotten that wrong. So what I'd like to do is sort of skip through some of the major arguments in the book and some of the pieces you may have read, and so we can sort of get to a discussion, and I really hope that we can have a vigorous one. And I want to start with sort of the problem that animates my thinking here. Anybody played with the Google Books n-gram? You can waste a lot of time with this. You can put any term into this, and you'll find out how frequently it appeared in English language books. And you can divide by American or Anglo-American. And here's the term working class from 1970 to 2008. And you can see we stop, we literally, in this case, stop talking about the term working class. And if you put in other terms, like free enterprise, you'll see the opposite. And it's a lot of fun to mess around with, and you can go straight to it from the Google website. So, you know, that was a something that came up after the book, but it was good fun. And here's a chart that I think that anybody who's interested in the subject matter will be completely familiar with. This is a graph of Gini coefficients, which is, of course, a measure of inequality, running from 1947 on the left to 2010 on the right. And the middle line is everybody. The lower line is whites, and the upper line is blacks. And you can see that inequality over here, what off the chart, is what economists call the Great Compression during World War II, where we taxed the top at a very high rate. And you know, this was a time where the top and the bottom got very close after the 30s and 40s. It continued downward as a result of the New Deal programs and collective bargaining and redistributive wealth and all the rest. And then during our time that we're going to look at today, it begins to creep back up and then shoots up quite dramatically into the our own time. I mean, think for a minute that just in the late 50s and early between 1960. I'm just throwing this out, so don't quote me. But I think something like between 1960 and 1972, white workers' income went up 42%. I mean, it's really astonishing, especially as compared to the stagnation that we see today. The actual numbers somewhere in the book, this is the reality we live in. And then the question is, well, should that matter? Should we care? Why should we care? And I think I've been using this book by Wilkinson and Pickett called The Spirit Level. And I don't know if people are familiar with this, but they basically look at global inequality. They compare advanced industrial countries, and they say, what's the relationship between inequality and a host of social maladies, right? And this is a critique of the idea that, well, as long as nobody's starving, we should let the rich get richer. Well, their argument is that there's a direct relationship between income inequality and a host of social ills. So, and this is their overall graph, income inequality going from low to high, and these social maladies going from better to worse, and the index includes life expectancy, math literacy, infant mortality, homicides, imprisonment, teenage births, trust, obesity, et cetera, et cetera. And they go even as far as to include happiness. And certainly social mobility, and then perhaps a lot of you know that the American dream of social mobility is alive and well in Denmark, and it's not here. And so what you find in the United States way up here in the most extreme corner of this high inequality and worse social indices. So this matters. And unless we're thinking about inequality, unless we're thinking about how class works, then this is, I think, the political effect. I co-taught, last semester, I co-taught a great class with two psychologists, actually. And they said, we assigned that book, and they said that made perfect sense, because psychologically, the way people make sense of the world is very relative to others. And if you feel like you are not connected to the other people, you get very anxious, and people tend to get very anxious, and anxiety is one of the most corrosive psychological things that we can experience. And this is another author we looked at last semester as well, this guy Dan Ariely, who is probably the most creative social scientist working today, I think. And he did this blind taste test of countries. I don't know whether you're familiar with this. He said, told people, what do you think the distribution of wealth is in America by quintile? And this is how people estimated it right here. That the top 20% had this much, the next 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 20% had that much wealth. And what's interesting is he broke it down by Republican, a Democrat, income, men, women, everything, and it's a pretty consistent package. But it has very little relationship to the real distribution of income, which is the top two have so little they're not even on the chart. But then the interesting thing is, and this I find very helpful, he said, where would you like to live? What would you imagine the world, what's your best society? If you're the Rawlsian, what is it, blind?
Original.
Veil of ignorance, huh? It's veil of ignorance, right? Yeah. Where would you like to be? And this is what they created.
Which is Sweden.
Which is, you know, so they think they live in Sweden, they want to live in Finland, but they live in, you know, a banana republic. This is kind of the crazy place we find ourselves.
Who is this that came up with
this? This guy's name is Ariely, A-R-E-L with a Y.
What's the book?
Damn. It's not a book, it's just a study. If you Google his name and you go to his website, and he does these really imaginative experiments like this. It's really worth spending some time with this guy. Now, very few of them have to do with inequality. But he's a behavioral economist, and a very creative one. Okay, so I set out to, in this book, 10 years ago, to try and figure out how we got into this place. So what happened and why? How did we get from that place of shrinking inequality to expanding inequality? And there's all sorts of explanations for this. You know, political backlash allowed conservative policies to come in, stagflation crushed the old model, suburbanization, southernization. There are many. And I basically say yes to all of them in a certain way. Although I think it's a bit of a perfect storm in a lot of ways that delivers us to another problem, and that is the fragility of class in America as an idea. That I think it existed. And if you go back in the documents, you'll see reporters and people talking about the working class. I mean, in mainstream papers, it was a very common term in the 60s and 70s. But still, I think that the way it crumbled, if you'll buy my argument that it crumbled, was suggestive of its inherent weakness, and we can sort of return to that. So if you read the introduction, anybody read the introduction? Okay, somebody maybe did. This is Dewey Burton. These are the, when I started to write this book, I decided I didn't want to do the usual historian's trick of the cute anecdote followed by three arguments as the introduction. And so I was looking for a kind of thematic glue to hold it together, and I found this guy who was interviewed by the New York Times in 1970, 72, 74, 76, and 80 as a sort of representative blue-collar worker. And he turned out to be remarkably smart, literate, interesting guy, and I went down and I interviewed him from his home where he retired in Florida, and it was great. And his wife still looks exactly like him. I kid you not. They just came up and visited us this summer, actually. And you know, Dewey pinpointed something that I think a lot of historians and economists and things also pinpointed, but that becomes a central organizing principle for the book, and that is the juncture of 1973, 74, 75, that early mid-decade moment. First half of the book is called Hope in the Confusion. Second half of the book is called Despair in the Order. And the idea is that a lot is going on in the first half of the 1970s. Michael Harrington said America's going left, right, and center vigorously at the same time. You know, and that really sort of captures both the sense of expansiveness and possibility of that kind of post-60s moment. It's really kind of part of the 60s. And then the more claustrophobic mood of the second half of the decade. The way Dewey captured it, and you've read it, but I want to share it because I found it really profound. I mean, I've been looking for a way to illustrate this because I saw it in so many ways. And Michael Harrington wrote an essay in Dissent called A Collective Sadness in 1974. I mean, it was palpable. And so what he said, and even though a lot of you read it, I'm going to read it. In 1974, midterms, he said, something's happening to people like me, working stiffs, as they say. And it isn't just that we have to pay more for this or that, or that we're having to do without this or make do with a little less of that. It's deep, and it's hard to explain. But it's more like more and more of us are leaving our hopes outside in the rain and coming into the house and just locking the door, you know, just turning the key and click. That's it for what we always thought we could be. And I really think that a lot of that sort of hopeful, expansive confusion in the first half of the decade got funneled into that moment. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. But that it's key to understanding things is to see that turning point. I think as you know, it's sort of the inverse of 1936 or something like that. The Watergate, you know, Nixon resigns. We're pulling out of Vietnam. You know, we've ended the war in 73. We pull out in 75. Stagflation is hit. The oil crises are happening. It's bad news. And so, the first time that Dewey appears in the press is in 1970. And that's definitely part of the more hopeful period, given my values. And that was during this large-scale rank-and-file unrest that's happening throughout the country in workplaces where people are pushing against both management and the union. And Dewey was one of those in 1970. He was part of this kind of anti-establishment unrest in the factories. That led to some of the biggest rank-and-file democratization movements we've ever seen in American labor history against, you know, existing institutions. Steelworkers Fight Back, Miners for Democracy, these big insurgencies. But it wasn't always clear where things were going. Pete Hamill, the great journalist, said, "The working-class white man is actually in revolt against taxes, joyless work, the double standards and short memories of professional politicians, hypocrisy, and what he considers the debasement of the American dream." But what direction that's going to go, we don't know. Dewey went after this guy, George Wallace, segregationist governor of Alabama who ran as an independent in 68, ran as a Democrat in 1972. And the next time he gets interviewed is in 72 because he is supporting Wallace. And the press is up in arms. Why are blue-collar workers voting, or in the North, voting for this backlash populist guy? And in fact, he wins Maryland. He does win Maryland, but I mean he wins Michigan. You know, the core of the UAW Democratic Labor Liberal nexus. And it's because of busing that Dewey Burton is angry that he bought a house near the school. And now he lives in outside of Detroit. He's having to have his kids bust around. Well, but here's the volatility of the moment, right? So then Wallace got shot, actually, the day before that primary. And what does Dewey do? He said, well, how's he going to vote? They go back and interview him in the fall, and he votes for McGovern, the most left-leaning presidential candidate that the two-party system, I think, has ever created. So, you know, you can kind of see things going multiple directions at this one, Simon. You know, here's sort of a collage of imagery that I think that the hard hat became not only a symbol but a term for the white working class at this moment. And here you can see it sort of heading off in multiple directions. Here's Richard Nixon, signing hard hats down on the docks, and he really makes a very concerted push to win over working class voters on cultural grounds rather than economic grounds. His whole tactic was to shift the union and working class vote away from economic issues and towards cultural issues, and to create what is the post-Rooseveltian coalition, which he did in 1972. He was very successful. Had it not been for Watergate, the so-called Reagan coalition probably would have happened in 1972. Hubert Humphrey, with his monogram argument, at a steel workers' rally, you know, the liberal darling, the inheritor of the New Deal and the Great Society, but also a guy saddled with the Vietnam legacy. But here's the traditional stalwart, labor's darling, right? The way workers are supposed to vote and the way liberal candidates are supposed to be. And then George McGovern, in 72, also signing a hard hat, trying to make a new coalition of young workers, anti-war workers, workers that are willing to make a coalition with students, although having a hell of a difficult time, because everywhere he campaigns, he ends up running across the wall of supporters. And then finally, another version that gets underplayed in the backlash, and that was this insurgent worker. And that we see with, this is a Mexican-American worker, Gary, who is supporting Ed Sedlowski, who is part of Steelworkers Fight Back, this organization that's mobilizing to democratize the steelworkers union and to bring new issues to the fore, environmental issues, issues of race, gender, and other forms of equity that have been left out of the post-war bargain. But one of the problems we have is the new left. Or at least not if not the new left, the counterculture, and of course those are slightly different categories. And again, the inversion of the 30s, rather than a popular front, as you had in the 1930s, you have workers and student, or at least the sort of counterculture youth movement, at odds with each other. That the working class becomes sort of this objectified, anti-progressive, anti-Enlightenment, anti-60s figure, an obstacle to the future of change. They are, you know, defenders of white privilege. They're sort of relegated to the past, I think, in a lot of this. Now, there's great crossover in a lot of those insurgencies I was talking about, but I think you get a sense of, obviously, you all know this is Easy Rider, I presume. But you get a sense, I think, in this most iconic of countercultural films, the direction that things are going. You have two riders, they score some dope, they drive east. You're not supposed to drive east, you're always supposed to drive west in movies. They run across some white rednecks at the end of the movie, and this is their fate. The road trip of the 60s ends. Two groups, at least in popular culture, being played out by you. Two interesting things about this. One, Terry Southern, one of the writers of Easy Rider, said that that was supposed to evoke the Jodes, you know, the Tom Joad and the Okies and the whole Grapes of Wrath, which of course is the iconic American working class hero of the 20th century. Now it's kind of an inverted proletariat. It's the anti-hero. The other is he wanted it to be, and this is pretty close to a quote, an indictment of blue-collar America, which I held responsible for the Vietnam War. You know, just some really kind of crazy thinking. The first argument I sort of base my overall argument on is that the rank and file insurgency of the early 70s fails. It fails for a variety of reasons. I think I list like five or something in the book. And that was really kind of the main hope, I think, for revitalizing the labor movement, revitalizing liberalism. This is perhaps the most iconic of these rebellions, the Lordstown plant in Ohio, which is the fastest assembly line in the world, where in 1972 workers rebelled not just against General Motors, but the union as well, saying they wanted a more humane workplace, that the speed of the assembly line was dehumanizing. And they became kind of young, hip, rebellious, anti-war, interracial, dope-smoking workers. This was played out in the press, all over the press. But this, like the rest of the insurgency in the early 70s, collapses in 73 and 74. So you have tensions with the major social movements of the 60s. You know, the failure of these really important insurgencies of the early 70s. And they weren't complete failures. A lot of the people who came out of that movement went on to lead the labor movement today. Third, you have the rise of a populist conservatism. And this is, of course, the hard hat riot in Manhattan in 1970 that came out in favor of the war, attacking anti-war protesters in the financial district and beating them up, and then throughout the month of May had rolling protests against Mayor Lindsay, against the anti-war movement, in favor of Nixon, in favor of the war, in favor of God Bless the Establishment, was a very popular sign. And here was, you know, what some people call country and Western Marxism, others call the Marx upside down. You know, here's the inverted proletariat. When this happened, Nixon was actually in his offices debating what to do about the blue-collar worker, how tactically to go after the blue-collar vote in 1972. And this says, okay, great, now we have the shock troops for what we want. That is a cultural conservative insurgency. And that argument connects readily with the inability of the liberals to map out a strategy that will attract blue-collar workers. And this is a McGovern flyer that expresses, I think, something more profound than they even meant. And that is, you know, obviously they're trying to goad people and say, how can you vote for this guy? But really, I think they're asking themselves, what the hell is going on? I don't get it. And up at the top is a little note there. It says, I printed 10,000 for distribution in Hialeah, Florida, which is the heart of Wallace country, of course. And McGovern, in interviews and his own writings, later said that he could not believe the Wallace support, the support that Wallace was getting in the factories. And at the same time, while McGovern and Humphrey were stymied by the white working class support for Wallace, Nixon made a study of it. Nixon got down to work and really, really made a close study of Wallace's tactics and decided that he could really build his new coalition. As he theorized, he said, and this was in a private meeting with his Ehrlichman and all these guys, Chuck Colson and George Shultz and all these guys. He says, we need to build our own new coalition based on silent majority, blue-collar Catholics, Poles, Italians, and Irish. No promise with the Jews and the Negroes. Appeal not hard right-wing or Bircher or anti-communist. And so, you know, he didn't want to be that rabid right-winger. He wanted to bring people in And he also said something interesting. We're not going to attack the institutions of workers. So in other words, we're not going to go out and attack the unions. We're going to be friendly to them. And he actually had a huge Labor Day celebration at the White House and invited zillions of workers out and union leaders. And in fact, when he got in trouble, Nixon, in Watergate in 1974, he went on the Grand Ole Opry and did yo-yo tricks with Roy Acuff and played the piano with George Wallace in the front row. But of course, we know what happened to his presidency. So the insurgency fails. The labor liberal agenda is in tatters. One way to think about the way it falls apart is that the 72 primary had three candidates that were really three wings of a party that was falling apart. Hubert Humphrey, the old school liberals, George Wallace, kind of the conservative populist, and George McGovern of sort of the new left. And had the reason really, I think, for McGovern's nomination is that they had a hard time. He sort of achieved victory over a fragmented party. And then the appeal of this conservatism. But at the same time, some liberals did begin to think about ways to bring this together. One of the most important, I argue, in the book is, well, not one of the most important, but there's a collection of things that I call the New Deal That Never Happened. And a lot of people at mid-decade began to see what was going on. And they said, we really need to revitalize this sort of labor-liberal coalition. And the New Deal That Never Happened, I rest on two pillars and a few others. One is labor law reform that ended up being defeated by a filibuster for lack, really, of one vote. The other is the full employment legislation, which was seen not just as an echo of Roosevelt's call for full employment, but a way to achieve affirmative action in an equitable manner. That in difficult times, you can't just toss white workers out of work and put black workers in. And this was, you know, even Cleveland Robinson of the Coalition of Black Trade Unionists and things were advocating this. But in fact, you need a full employment economy. And this goal was to reorient federal planning away from consumption or Wall Street and toward full employment. And this is a rally in 1975, filling up RFK Stadium to the brim for advocates of full employment. And I might add, unemployment was lower than it is today. The main legislative vehicle for full employment ideas were the Humphrey-Hawkins Full Employment Act, bringing together Hubert Humphrey and Gus Hawkins from Watt, a congressman from Watts. And this actually, believe it or not, passed in 1978. A bill that actually started out including the federal guarantee of a job for all citizens. By the time they were done with it, it was nothing. It was actually kind of a cynical political thing. But what's interesting about the Full Employment Act, I think, is that a great number of people felt compelled to support this thing. And in fact, did support it. A more jaundiced view comes in these cartoons, though. The top one is... here's a locomotive that says Democrats in 76, and in it is every George Meade's here, Jimmy Carter's here, Humphrey's here, Udall, Urban League, I can't remember who all's up there. The train is labeled the Humphrey-Hawkinsville, and they're gonna get the bowl of unemployment out of the way. But it's really interesting, it's an engine without an engine, and there's just this guy up here blowing smoke out the smokestack, or this one where Jimmy Carter is reading a Mother Goose fairy tale to the precocious Amy Carter, who says, you know, she doesn't want that fairy tale. She says, no, read the Humphrey Hawkins bill again. So in addition to that, there's discussions of national health insurance. The UAW supports Carter because he says he's for national health insurance. Some talk of industrial policy, especially later in his administration. But by and large, all of these things fail or are gutted or are debilitated in a variety of ways. So this attempt to reunite the old around the old religion kind of falls apart. And I think all of this creates a void that conservative thought very easily fills. When Reagan comes along, he's able to make sense of this in a way that a lot of other people aren't. Let me quote a very famous quote from Doug Fraser, the head of the United Auto Workers in 1978. This is after Humphrey Hawkins has failed. It's after labor law reform has failed, and he's exasperated. He's had it with what's going on, and he resigns from this labor management consulting group that's supposed to advise the president on labor management organizations, labor management issues. And he says, and I quote, he does this very ceremonial resignation in front of the press. And delivers this letter and says, I believe leaders of the business community, with few exceptions, have chosen to wage a one-sided class war in this country today, a war against working people, the unemployed, the poor, the minorities, the very young, and the very old, and even many in the middle class of our society. The leaders of industry, commerce, and finance in the United States have broken and discarded the fragile, unwritten compact previously existing during a past period of growth and progress. So, 1978. And if you read Winner Take All Politics, Pearson and Hacker, they basically say people spend way too much time emphasizing 1968 as a turning point in politics. It's really 78. 1978 is when the world turns politically. And so, you know, I thought I'd talk a little bit about, to wrap up so we can have a discussion, the reason everybody comes to my talks is to hear disco. For those who didn't read the pop culture chapter, I based the title of the book is on this song. I was shocked when I actually got around to reading the lyrics when I was beginning to work in the 70s, the essence of which, music loud and women warm, I've been kicked around since I was born. Now it's all right, it's okay, you can look the other way. It's permission to forget. It's permission to deny, it's permission to forget, which is what Tony Manero does, the John Travolta character in this book, or in this movie. Trivial Pursuit fans might know that that's John Travolta's sisters serving the pizza. The things you'll learn. So what's interesting about this film is this rock critic, Nick Cohn, goes out to do a sort of reportage piece on the working class disco scene in Brooklyn. And he gets in a cab and goes out there with this disco dancer named Too Sweet. And he gets out of the cab, and there's a brawl in the parking lot, and somebody throws up on him, and it, you know, it's a disaster. So he gets back in the cab and goes back to Manhattan. But out of the corner of his eye, he sees a guy in a red crimson shirt and a leather jacket and flared pants. And he says, that's 70s cool. And, and Tony Manero was born. The interesting thing was he went out and he wrote this piece for New York Magazine called The Tribal Rights of the New Saturday Night with an inset box that said, the editors made him put this in, that said, everything I write about is true. He later, about 20 years later, wrote a piece in Rolling Stone saying, I made it all up, nothing at all, like, I didn't see any of it, I just made it up. But it really does fit the 70s in a lot of ways. And in the piece, he says there are the faceless, there are the blob, there's the blob, there's the faceless ones, and there are the chosen ones. They're the ones that'll get out. They're the ones who have the capacity, the greatness to leave, and then there's the rest. And Tony is one of the chosen ones. And this is an important, you know, sort of anti-Capra-esque moment where the chosen one doesn't help the community, but leaves the community. And in this moment, in the dance contest, he realizes that his superior skills on the dance floor are real. I mean, he's a great dancer, everybody recognizes that. But that he's not as good as he thought he was. He realizes the Puerto Rican couple are better than he is, are better dancers. But because it's an Italian disco, an Italian neighborhood, they have to give the prize to the Italian. And this is a moment of crisis for him. He's buoyed by ethnic and kinship and all that kind of stuff. It's not the meritocracy he thought. He hasn't truly proven himself.
You put them down, don't you, did? No, princess.
You phony bastards. You know who should have won that contest. My own fucking friends can't even be straight with me. You gotta lie right through your fucking teeth. Come on.
Your ass, man.
Look, we won it.
Stephanie, that was rigged. That's like family. They can't give it to no spick or no stranger. What, are you crazy?
We was just as good as they were, Tony, and I know it.
Oh, you think so, huh?
Yeah. Hey!
Come with me. Excuse me. Congratulations. Yeah, can I give you this or I can give you that? Because I think you deserve it, all right? Come on. God damn it, good is good. If the spicks are good, they deserve it. That's
what
we're
just doing.
It's a fucking shithole, you know that? A fucking shithole! God damn it. Friends are assholes I hang out with. I can't believe them sometimes, you know that? Everybody's got to dump on somebody, right? Of course. I mean, everybody can't do it straight, right? My pa goes to work and gets dumped on, so he comes home and he dumps on my mother, right? Of course, right? Then the spicks, they dump on us, so we got to dump on the spicks, of course, right? Everybody's dumping on everybody. Even the Humpins dump them most of the time.
All right, okay, listen, would you just tell me what's wrong, okay? What is it?
Get in!
Just tell me. The hell is wrong with you?
And so he gives a sort of primitive Marxist sociology here where he says, everybody's got to dump on somebody and it all runs downhill. And then he goes on to try to prove it by trying to rape Stephanie in the following scene. And it's amazing. If you 10 out of 10 people do not remember there's a rape scene in Saturday Night Fever. I mean, it's amazing.
maybe 10 out of 10.
10 out of men, yeah, maybe. No, but actually, even women. There's been a lot of women. Don't, I mean, it's not part of the narrative. But yeah, I'm sure there's a distinct gender divide on that one. So he has to leave, right? And of course, people have been getting out of town since, you know, Huck doing first love. But it's with a distinct vengeance in Saturday Night Fever and other movies and other films throughout the late 70s. There's kind of this new individualism emerging where the chosen ones will get out. But in order to do that, you have to leave behind this kind of nasty race, class, gender, violent stew back in Brooklyn. And he gets on a train and he rides all night, and then before emerging ultimately on the other side in Manhattan. And he is reborn. Literally a new day is dawning at the end of the movie, as you'll see. And he goes to be with Stephanie to try and to have some sort of platonic relationship. But as he does, if she's inhabiting somebody else's apartment, they're in a completely different world, really, a different socioeconomic place. And music changes. So, one place class goes is towards the past. It's somewhere else. It's in some other place. It's relegated to some other time and space. Another is to be folded into kind of a conservative populist Americana. It dissolves into being, as I argue in the piece, born in the USA. That you in that song the pain of class is hidden underneath the patriotic anthem and chant of being born in the USA. And I think another is it becomes racialized, which I think has been underneath a lot of the so-called, and class engendered actually, underneath the so-called class solidarity of the post-war period, is unable to withstand the challenge put to it by the new social movements, and that it ends up sort of being a white, blue-collar form of identity politics, because it proves unable to the post-war paradigm cannot make room for the new claims on it by the women's movement, by the civil rights movement, and other things. Ironically, now the labor movement is one of the most diverse institutions in America, if not the most diverse institution in America. But it is a shadow of its former self in terms of its economic and political power. I could go on and on, but I was told to just sort of give the best primer I could in the time allotted, so I welcome your questions.
Good. Should we put the more lights on?
Yeah, more lights on the subject.
Okay, so Jeff, do you want to just field some comments and questions?
You want me to?
Maybe we'll take a few, and then you could respond.
Okay.
Sue.
Thanks, Jeff. You probably know what I'm going to ask you.
You can go first. I'll go second.
Believe me, it's been asked before.
Yes. But I thought I'd get it on the table right away. So the question, the term working class disappears.
Right.
Mm-hmm. One question is what replaces it. Mm-hmm. But it seems to me that you're in all of the kind of problems that you raise. There's one element that you haven't really looked at, and that is the issue of gender.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you think, okay, the term disappears at the very moment when
right.
there's a kind of rise in women in the workforce, for one thing. Okay, and married women, and so there's this real shift in who is the working class, even as the term is disappearing. So that's one thing. Then you're saying, well, the rise of the right wing, how do we explain that? And that also rests heavily on a gendered ideology, which is sort of in opposition to the very fact of sort of women entering the workforce. And the inability of liberals to map out a blue-collar strategy, again, is because they, like you, are sort of defining a blue-collar strategy as a white male working class strategy. And maybe if there was a way to have thought about the term or a blue-collar strategy in another way, they might have not lost that constituency. So, I also thought it was, this whole idea of thinking about what term replaced working class is not insignificant in thinking about those issues and why that term declined. And so I know you've heard this question before, and I thought maybe it'd be a good idea for you to talk about it.
I would put there are lots of ways to sharpen the point. If you looked at working poor, if you looked at welfare, if you looked at poor, And I understand that there is an argument. I am well aware that there is a distinction between the term poor people and working class people. But I wonder if the people being described by those terms caught up in those sociological, historical, journalist, whatever, are not the same people, or that they capture exactly the kinds of distinctions that Sue is making. And then I guess my other question is, like, I mean, I read the popular culture chapter. The argument, for example, about 9 to 5, which I just watched the other day because it was on television and it was funny. Like, there's this way that that's dismissed as this, like, feminist revenge fantasy and not a story about class. But, like, they propose job sharing. They propose full-time daycare. They propose beautifying workspace. They propose things that have fundamental consequences for the way human beings inhabit employment. And it's dismissed as, like, they just tie up Dabney Coleman in, like, an S&M fantasy. And it is no longer about a kind of class politics. And it seems to me that that really raises the question of what it means. Class is dismissed by some people, but it becomes critical to other people. It just doesn't get talked about in the same way. But that doesn't mean that the substance of it isn't there, I guess is how I would sharpen that.
Yeah, I'd agree with everything except your last sentence. But we'll
all right.
I could, maybe I should talk about the gender.
You should do that line, because it's not exactly the opposite question. Do those, and I'll ask you the opposite. In other words, I'm not on their side.
Okay, so the anybody who wants to see my full response to this issue can look in the
journal
Democracy.
Oh.
Jen Klein wrote a very good review of the book in Democracy, a journal of ideas, I think, and raised exactly the set of questions. And what I said in that was, we need to talk about diversity and decline at the same time. But not say one is causing the other. Mm-hmm. And this is the problem with, I think, sort of the triumphalism you see in something like Nancy McLean's Freedom Is Not Enough, where it becomes, the EEOC diversifies the workplace, and that's great. And people use that tool, and they are able to pry open spaces and the job. And this is the area in which women are going to work. And yeah, there's industrial decline, but there's a rise in the service sector. The service sector is far more diverse than the white male industrial sector. But I think we need to be able to talk about both at the same time. That just talking about the diversification and the integration of the workplace and the changes towards the service sector does not deny the fact that there's an absolute collapse in how we think about ourselves, that collective economic rights fall apart in this country. And that there are certain people who wield individual rights on those, and they're very important. But by and large, that we have an achievement of diversity in the midst of a decline. And that's a tragedy, because it means that those claims on workplaces and the rest are happening in a shrinking economic pie. And, you know, the 60s happened in workplaces in America in the 70s, and that's a distinctly less generous time for it to be happening, right? I really think that the buoyant economy helped make the 60s the 60s. And the shrinking economy in the 70s helps explain a lot of that. Where does it go? I think it goes into, and this is the risk of identity politics, I think, in general, that white men glom onto that. And that, well, let me back up. First of all, the term working class that I'm dealing with is one, I think, inherited from the post-war period. That the whole New Deal paradigm is largely a white and male paradigm, and that's its problem, right? That's its limitation. And that it proves inelastic, it proves uncapacious. There's not enough space there in the way people are thinking about it for a more expansive and diverse working idea of what working class is. That I think the working class, if you want to create some objective notion of what it is a very multicultural, gender neutral term, but obviously not in practice. So we have this sort of a kind of brittle ideology of what it means. You have the storm of the 60s, and it just cannot make it. And so what you see, I think, is at least among people at one point who might, white male workers who might have thought themselves more as working class, are more likely to see themselves as Americans, as white, as Christians, as a whole host of things that aren't about
I have to just say something else.
Sure, yeah,
I mean, you're saying you're sort of dismissing the comments about gender as being identity politics, but actually, about the institution, the central institution that you're talking about, which is the trade union movement, right? I mean, this is really the key to your argument that the unions are declining, and that's sort of a symbol of the declining class. It's exactly those institutions that are in decline that are unable to figure out a way to absorb these new members of the working class.
Exactly.
And that's the problem. And that's a problem with not just the institutions, but then the politics as well. So it's not an add-on in that sense. It's a fundamental...
No, I think we're in total agreement about that.
But it doesn't come, it's interesting because you say at some level, like, they have to be taken up together, and I feel like, but I don't see how you're doing that, I guess is my question. So I agree, they have to be taken up together, and I feel like feminist historians have been taken to task for it and have tried to think about ways to do it. And then I feel like there's this analysis where it's like, well, we're talking about class and we're trying to do it, but it's like, there are no women. Mm-hmm. There are no women. Mm-hmm. Where are the women? Women have always worked. Where are they?
Right. I mean, and where were they?
But where are they? Where are they?
Right. Okay. So I want to go back to my earlier point that this is a study of ideology, I think. This is a study of ideas. And the idea of the working class that is at work, that at work in the culture, is a largely white and male paradigm.
What was Humphrey Hawkins? What was Humphrey Hawkins aiming for? What kinds of jobs constituted a full employment economy?
What that number was hotly contested.
I mean, not just the number, but sort of the idea of what. Those jobs were.
All over the place. So the idea was to prime the private sector as best they could in a variety of ways. But then, barring that, it would be the mechanism would be communities would help decide what jobs they wanted. So, and the emphasis was actually on daycare centers, on schools, and on public works projects. But it was supposed to be kind of a sort of maximum feasible participation idea.
We should let Walter.
But let me just one thing. If you think about the dominant paradigm of or dominant policy thing, it becomes the EEOC and not the NLRB after the 70s. And you know, one works, one doesn't. One's based on individual rights, one's based on collective rights. And I'm not even a fan of the NLRB or NLRA, but I think that's kind of the one way to think about the switch.
Yeah, well, actually, it sort of picks up on that. I mean, your reading of the little moment when Tony gives the prize. So it seems like exactly the opposite of primitive Marxism. It seems to be kind of like advanced neoliberalism. I mean, what is it that happens at that moment? You know, these guys have not gotten it because they've been discriminated against, and Tony recognizes that injustice. And actually, another way to start sort of ideology in the 70s, which wouldn't be like movies and worse rock and roll. Think of there, Bruce Springsteen. But with
what the hell's going on?
Becker's dissertation was reprinted for a larger audience in 1971. So, like, one of the founders of the other book, Economics, of course, what the dissertation is the economics of discrimination. And it's an argument, precisely, has no concept of class at all. It's an argument entirely that, inefficient markets, discriminating employers cannot survive. And that the goal of making efficient mm-hmm. markets must require anti-discrimination, otherwise those fall by the wayside. So what you get is, and this is a way to think about diversity of various kinds in relation to the events you're describing, what you get is a logic in which when Tony articulates the commitment to, in effect, neoliberal anti-discrimination, doesn't mean, of course, just to put neoliberal in front of it doesn't make anti-discrimination wrong. Anti-discrimination is right. But he articulates, in effect, what is an emerging. And we don't even have to go to identity politics and the delusions around that. We go rather to the emerging sense that the core of social justice, and the core of equality. I'm glad to think of this because I got an email from Doug Henwood about, 3 hours ago. You know, Doug Henwood is the editor and writer of the Left Business Observer. And what it actually says, if I can quote this, is Lloyd Blankfein, everyone know who the word Blankfein is? Lloyd Blankfein? Lloyd Blankfein is the CEO of Goldman Sachs. And he just won an award. I guess Doug felt I should hear about it. He won an award from the Human Rights Campaign, civil rights organization.
Yeah.
Because Goldman Sachs ranks 100% on all the human rights issues. And as they say, America's corporations learned long ago, I would say like in 1971, that equality is just good business and is the right thing to do. And in this particular case, it's LGBTQ issues that they're focusing on. So that the logic precisely of anti-discrimination and the logic of equality as sort of founded in anti-discrimination is a logic which actually has no room for class whatsoever. Because, of course, class differences are not founded primarily in anti-discrimination. Class differences are founded on economic exploitation, which is often enabled by discrimination, but actually has, in many cases in recent years, been enabled by anti-discrimination. And so what you have is actually a certain kind of tension between two quite different sets of ideological ideals, one of which is precisely the kind of diversity that you're interested in talking about the sort of revolutionary, the young emperor cornets of the 70s, but also one which actually then, insofar as you produce a workforce, which is indeed a workforce, which is above all concerned with EEOC issues, where I agree with you, is one that actually in principle has no interest whatsoever in those other issues, because precisely the kind of motivating force for the people who run those businesses of the EEOC issues is that they make for, as Lloyd Blankfein so eloquently says, like they're good for business. Mm-hmm. So there's an important sense then in which you can't actually just do, you know, what you're being asked to do is, well, put feminism and presumably anti-racism and a whole series of other issues like that together with this. But you can't just put them together because actually, historically, for the last 30 years, they've worked against each other. So they're not part of the same thing. And it's not as if that the guys had just made the unions more diverse, they would have had any more success.
Well, I disagree with that.
Which part?
The last sentence, because that's all I can remember, apparently.
Yeah, the last sentence.
But no, I actually think that if you go back to some of the insurgencies of the early 70s, where they're saying, look, we got a race problem, we got a gender problem, we got an environmental problem, we've got an industrial crisis looming. And if you had an agenda that included those issues, that made it to the top of the labor movement's agenda, instead of the opposite, which was, let us kill anybody who's challenging the power of the AFL-CIO, literally, sometimes, then I think you would have a different thing. That if you consciously seek a broader coalition, that you could have changed things.
Yeah,
that's the what if in the book.
But the point of a larger, right, the point of introducing Becker is that from the employer standpoint, from the capitalist standpoint, the race issue is a problem. You've got to solve it. You need anti-discrimination. The gender issue is a problem. You've got to solve it. That's what Goldman Sachs is trying to do. Those are issues you have to solve. The Gini issue, not only do you not have to solve that, but the more you succeed in solving the others, the more you enable that Gini code thing to grow. I mean, the last version of this, just to give an example of that. One of the big things about globalization, right, you have a bunch of feminist economists who've done a series of studies on the effects of globalization on women's pay. And what they found is not surprising, it's what they were supposed to find, is that in companies that are exposed to a lot of global competition, and therefore have to be efficient to survive. The pay of women managers goes up.
Well, here's another angle on that.
But the pay of everybody else, right, that is, the pay of the managers goes down.
Well, my colleague Fran Blau, one of the great women historians who looks at gender in the labor market, concluded that, you know, you always you know how we measure women's pay as a percentage of men's? She made the basic calculation that we're pegging that on a declining value. So men's wages are stagnating or going down. And so women's wages may be going up, but as a percentage of men's, it's sort of a miserable index to be comparing it to, because as a result of industrial decline and rising inequality, women are gaining on men, but because men are falling, which is a rather desperate measure.
Yeah, but that's actually sort of not missing the main point, right? Which is that the main point here is that in situations like this, what I'm just describing, when you're talking about women managers, their salaries are going up objectively.
No, I know what you're saying.
Right.
I'm
so
adding
what
it's
going to be is, and what makes them go up objectively is precisely the same thing that makes the worker salaries, whether they're men, women, black, white, or green, go down. So there's a kind of conflictual relation mm-hmm. between the rise of the white collar, or the white collar, the rise of the management level mm-hmm. of a kind of commitment to equality, both in hiring, access to markets, and in pay and keeping them, and the decline of salaries at the lower level. And that's actually a structural problem. It's not an attitudinal problem.
Well, it sort of sounds a little like you end up blaming the women who are making more money. I mean,
it's
that is the one other way.
The point of structural is for a second not to worry about who to blame. Okay? The point of calling it structural is to say, no, actually, this is a function of the way the economy works in neoliberalism, and that a social movement which then just figures out who we should blame is a social movement that is totally fucking doomed to fail.
Well, but yeah, I would just say that there are a lot of queer people who would not be wanting to give Goldman Sachs that award. And so to put all LGBT people in the same category simply because HRC has given an award to a corporation that has exploited more queer people than probably any other, I mean, it's just, that's
well,
the same thing.
Goldman Sachs exploits a lot of people.
I understand that, but then don't.
The point for Goldman Sachs is that if they can find, and actually, BlindFind has said this, I looked at this before, I had like a little personal interest in BlindFind. Not on the money, but just the interest. He says over and over again, if any person, if a queer person, a black person, or whatever person can do the work we need them to do, well, the whole point of the meritocracy, I mean, he just talks just like Tony in Saturday Night Fever, which is that the people who can do the work, the people who can make our ill-gotten gains are the ones who are working for us. And that's just a kind of fundamental logic of neoliberal meritocracy. So from that standpoint, when you point out that some people don't support that, that's true. But it's not going to be on identity grounds. It's not going to be on anti-discrimination grounds. It's going to be on like, yeah, all the anti-discrimination in the world not only doesn't get you out of the exploitation, but actually intensifies the effectiveness of the exploitation.
Let me just ask if
somebody else.
No, other things that people would like to introduce. I have one, but let me defer to the rest of you first. Anne?
Oh, I just had a question. I think it was from the book we had read a few months ago in this group, Class Matters, and the rise and the use of the term the middle class mm-hmm. At the same time as the decline of the working class,
yeah.
Particularly in relation to this question of white working men or how the mm-hmm. middle class is perceived. But I just wanted to, you know, put that out there.
As a contemporary question or as a historical question?
I guess in the last, my impression is the proliferation of the term of the middle class in the last, 20 years or
yeah.
so, and how you see those speaking to each other.
Well, you know, what's interesting now is if you say middle class, you're a class warrior. Well, you know, that used to be the safe, vacuous term. But now if you're defending middle class values, suddenly you're declaring class war. I think that there's two issues, I think, at least. One is there's an historical problem with the term middle class that goes all the way back to, you know, and it's been a fuzzy term that has offered sort of little clarity. But that if you think of the term, what I use is the term professional middle class. And if you use that, then you have a very sharpened version. It's people, it's lawyers and accountants and people who are actually in the middle, academics, journalists, whatever, who are actually in between people who wield capital and people who do work. And then there's this whole kind of middle strata which is literally middle class rather than this empty term. But I think the use of the term historically also suggests something of the inherent weakness historically of class in America, of how we think about ourselves as a society, not the material reality, but the ideological sense. So that it always has been there. And so when I'm benchmarking the decline of working class on something that did exist, we did talk about it, but it was always slightly fragile and often superseded by a middle class sensibility.
May I follow up on that?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. I gotta go after you on that. I think.
What do you know about
that? sorry, I took it as a. So, I think there's been lots of mystifications related to that term, middle class, but I think there is been historically in the United States a lot of class consciousness and class antagonism reflected in various uses of the term middle class, going back to Tom Paine and the Anti-Federalists, going through the Knights of Labor and the Populists, and up even, you might argue, in the most mild, quite neoliberal terms, like in Obama's Kansas speech, which is the most class-conscious speech he's ever given, at least in his mainstream political career. And so I think there's that larger canvas on which actually your people are also playing with not just the term working class, but middle class as well. It's not just the professional middle class that is at play here. It's this term lower middle class, as you very well know, like Pete Hamill's writing article is titled Lower Middle Class. And the people who are commenting on these things can't figure out which term to use.
Right.
Lower middle class or working class, and in some ways it seems
white
the same
ethics.
Thing.
I mean, there's also this
right.
Kind of
so, is the lower middle class the same thing as the middle class? I was as the working class. I don't think we've been able to figure that out at all. But I think part of the virtue of using the term middle class is that even as strong as the term working class was politically and social democratically during its heyday, that if you really want to have some kind of democratic class politics in the United States, you're going to have to use middle class.
I think that's a really interesting point. I have a question for you. I'll turn it around. Do you think that from the 30s to the early 70s, there was more talk of working class instead of middle class?
Sure.
Okay. So that's, I think so too. I actually think this ties to another thing that makes me very unpopular, this argument about the long exception. That is that I think this period from the 30s to the 70s is rather unique in American history. And that I think a more diffuse populism has been the main theme of American descent, or whatever you want to call it, from the Gilded Age to the Progressive Era. Beyond the 70s, I think it is as well. But because unions are institutionalized and in the 30s and 40s, and do play such an important part in the post-war political economy, that I do think that you do see, I have no way of actually quantifying this, maybe I go back to my Google Books thing, but what I'm charting is that the tail end of that falling apart and sort of returning to the sensibility that I think you're talking about, that is more, that resonates more with the Gilded Age and Progressive Era now than, say, anything that did between the 40s and the 70s, if I made any sense at all of that.
Go ahead, Gary.
If I could just stay with the long exception for 1 second and bring it to the 70s. You said in that article one of the keys to this creation of a working class, the effectiveness of the working class in the New Deal was workers who had been exposed to a generation or more of Fordism, Taylorism, the gap, that traditional gap between the skilled worker and the unskilled worker had undergone almost its own great compression. I don't remember quite from the book, but in the 70s when all these new technologies are being instituted that allow for this, the rapid speed ups at Lordstown, and I'm sure happening outside the industrial sector and the service sector as well, is that compression going on, or is there a widening going on? And if that compression is going on, are these people who identify themselves as working class actors, are they noticing it, and are they using it to talk about the working class, and why didn't that make so much headway?
And when you're saying compression, you're talking about skill.
The compression of the gap between the skilled and the unskilled.
Yeah, I mean, there's an intellectual history chapter here that never quite made it to fruition. I mean, it was there, it was already like 100,000 words over, so the editor said no. But, and it talked about the so-called new class debates in the 1970s, which was sort of like the new intellectual workers and the service sector workers and things like that that were going to create a new work. I think that the issue was less the new reskilling or de-skilling, if you will, although that was certainly there. You have Braverman comes out in 75, Workers' Control in America comes out in 79, these very important works thinking about this. But really, the backstory in Lordstown is competition from the Japanese, right? That they have to now they're beginning and Germans are beginning to import small automobiles, especially, and so they have to make the Vega, and they want to make the Vega fast, and they want to make it efficiently, and they want to make it cheap, and so they, in order to compete, they crank up the speed of the assembly line, and then by the end of the decade they'll begin to offshore those things. So I think that's more kind of what's right there rather than de-skilling. I think by then it's kind of accepted that what Braverman calls the degradation of work has already been internalized to the point that's why they're going down to the basement and building stuff or tinkering in the garage with stuff or whatever rather than finding that kind of fulfillment on the job.
And that's by around 1974 that shift to despair.
Yeah, I mean, I might be putting too fine a point on that, sure. but I do think there was kind of a national mood question at that point.
I'd like to raise a different question, Jeff. I think you outlined the kind of tragedy of the period politically quite well, but is it really about class and the disappearance of the working class is my question. It seems like in the culture, as we see in the current election cycle, Americans really don't have a problem invoking class in various ways. Even Mitt Romney says he's not interested in the very poor or the very rich. I mean, he has his own view of the class structure. Occupy has another model. Obama has a model. Because of the economic distress of the country, people quite willingly resort to versions of class. I mean, not to be sure, not conventionally Marxist ones. But I don't know that that's ever been a favored framework of that big a group of Americans, or many others, really, in other countries, although to some extent. But I guess the question is, does that matter? Is class the crisis here, or the political story you tell, or is it, I guess the alternative framework to me would be to say it's trust in government that's at the issue, that are people willing to see, to band together around public programs, or have they lost faith in the capacity of the liberal state, whatever they think about class. And I guess it seems to me like the issues that bring this to a fore are, in your view, very American issues. There's the war in Vietnam. There's tendency for ethnic and or gender divisions among working people, and there's called stagflation, the end of the boom era, economic compression. Now, it seems like, I guess I'm wondering, how much change is there really of views of class? I don't think that the majority of people, certainly politically in the political universe, thought in terms of the working class in the 1960s either. That was when the late 60s was when I starting graduate school, I felt like I had, like I went to a year in Britain and I discovered class, and reading Marxist tradition. It wasn't some, and then it was also percolating in the New Left to a degree, but it was a discovery that like radicals and academics tended to make. So obviously there was a substratum of a left, but I don't know that that issue was the core of American political culture, and it seems more at the core was, even in terms of American reform moments, I mean, you invoked Gilded Age, Progressive Era, the New Deal. Isn't it more at the core of those moments shifting notions of nationalism and national political programs, and whether you could rally people, at least a majority constituency, behind those programs, not around a particular view of class. Mm-hmm. And even, so that would be the main question, but a second related question is, those peculiar American things about the divisions between like whites and Hispanics and so on, or even the war in Vietnam, those didn't agitate Britain in the same degree in these years, or other European countries. And yet it seems like, in general, their political drift has been more or less the similar.
Did you say similar or dissimilar?
Similar. In terms of the role there, particularly at least the fate of the political left in those countries has been similar, and the energy within the state-based projects of either, but in this country would be called liberal reform, or in those countries would be called more commonly social democracy. So how would you, I mean,
I'm having graduate school flashbacks.
No, I mean, I think these are big issues.
Man was famous for not writing anything on our papers, and then at the end asking the question that unraveled the whole enchilada. How I intellectually discovered class? I'd read, you know, Gutman and Gramsci and Marx and Fink and, you know, whomever. But it was The Hidden Injuries of Class, a 1970s book that basically said that, by two sociologists, that said, you know, class in America is shame. It's, and that's how I experienced it growing up. It wasn't about, the barricades. And I think, I still find it very compelling. I do think that, I'm trying to make an argument that's hard to balance. On the one hand, this is kind of weak to begin with. At the same time, it's important and falling apart. If you go back, there was a show called The David Susskind Show, sort of the Phil Donahue, Oprah show of the 70s. And if you go to my website, I hate to even say that word out loud, but if you go to my website, there's a thing that calls, it's a tab called 70s Archive, and you can go there and look at other videos and stuff like that. And one of them is an interview with Dewey Burton and three other workers on the Susskind Show. And if you just listen to how they talk, these guys aren't radicals, they're more probably more literate than, you know, a lot of working people, and are chosen because of that. But the way they talk is different. It's fundamentally the vernacular. The expression is different, the way they see the world is different than it is now. That there isn't a cultural change. It's very hard, I think, to pinpoint. It's slippery, but it's there. My favorite, or I think the reviews that I like the most of my book actually say, this is how it felt to be in the 70s, and that's what I'm after. And when I talk about working class, I'm not even talking about any limited Marxist sense. I'm actually talking about kind of how this works in the vernacular, that there is some kind of pride in what that means, that is not just in a diffuse kind of middle class. Trust in government, I think it's extremely important. And if you can graph it, I mean, there's, you know, all the polling data that shows there's a decline in trust in government. But it's not just trust in government, it's trust in institutions, all institutions. And this gets to the bowling alone effect, where you have a decline in civic participation, civic engagement of a variety of types, including trade unions, Boy Scouts, YMCA, bridge clubs, you know, whatever it is, Democratic Party, Republican Party, whatever. People, you know, there's a decline in all of that. And I think we become more individual, less associational after this decade. And Putnam places that on suburbanization and television and a whole host of other things, but it's there. The first thing I wrote when you started to talk is, you know, you said there's a variety of invocations of class in America today. If you want to listen to political discourse today and you want to hear the working class, there's two people you need to listen to. One is David Brooks, who uses it more than anybody else, and the other is Rick Santorum, who will use it more than anybody else. And they use it in a completely different way than probably most of us would. That the right actually uses this term as a point of pride. It's not gone, it's changed. You know, this is back to your question, Sue. What happened to it? And I actually think that, you know, they are safe enough in their invocation of it because it means something completely different now than a point of sort of economic identity. It's an adjective. Hang on, before you jump all over. And finally, the global comparison, which I think is really important, right? The strike wave of between 68 and 74 was global. It happened in Mexico, it happened in Italy, it happened in France, it was all over the place. But it did have different impacts in those countries. And certainly the Anglo-American experience is parallel, although, you know, we don't have the miners' strike and things like this, and the winter discontent and other things. But, you know, they have Thatcher, we have Reagan, you know, there are parallels. But I think in Western Europe, the outcome of the strike wave is different. But I do think in the long run, because of the kind of the North Atlantic response to these things, that they get carried along, you know, that the neoliberal agenda, they get swept up in the neoliberal agenda because of the, you know, the hegemonic function of America in the 80s and 90s and beyond. I think there are different national experiences, and I think that there's also convergence, but I don't think the convergence is because their response is the same as ours.
So this would be just to go back, though. Mm-hmm. I mean, I suppose striking when you said that it was the hidden injuries of class and then shame. Mm-hmm. Then you get Santorum, and he's sort of trying to get rid of the shame and saying, no, it's pride. So that makes, I don't think those two things are as far apart as you were suggesting. I don't think it's a transformation of meaning. I think for you, it's sort of the same. That is, when you put up the Gini coefficients, I mean, I love doing all that. Usually, when I give lectures, I'm always the one beginning by putting up all versions of those graphs. And they include things like, you know, since 69, all the gains in American income have gone to the top 10% and bottom side. There's just millions of versions of that. Those are all kind of material facts. They're, however you want to understand, they're all material conditions. When you put up Gini coefficients, material conditions, when you think about like who's ashamed and who's proud, you're already in a sort of different relation to class. And when you're in a kind of Richard Sennett delusional relation to class, that is equality, you know, and go on a world of inequality, in which the real issues are cultural. And actually, if you did like an n-gram for diversity, or did an n-gram for cultural, it would be exactly the opposite of your working class one. It just like starts in the 70s and rises and rises and rises.
Uh-huh.
So you get the way in which it's precisely these questions of shame and questions of contempt and questions of pride, which are then also easily emphasized and easily gendered in various ways. And those, in effect, become the discourse of equality. And those, of course, are completely compatible discourses of equality with the actual facts of the matter, which, as you show, is rising inequality every step of the way from one time to the other. So it does seem like there's a certain sense in which I guess I want to hear more about, you know, you, I know you're familiar with some of the kind of like more materialist critiques of your book. So the only one I've read is Rick Dunn's. But where the sense there is, okay, there's a sense in which Mark,
there's this, the Labor Party guy.
Yeah, Labor Party guy. So there's a sense there in which, you know, part of the issue is, how do you understand? And this is not meant to be a polemical question, because I am sympathetic with the graphs, no part. How do you understand the relation between those material conditions? And then your own sort of beginning to slip off that and do a version of class which is precisely on a kind of like pride-shame version. And then the sort of question of the kind of cultural history you're doing, in which culture is also a word that like really gets going in the 70s, keeps on going down, and where actually a distinctively cultural history looks almost sort of more like part of the problem than part of the solution, because it precisely does focus on how people feel about themselves.
Well, I think you have to, yeah. I mean, on that part, I think you really got to disentangle those in order to be able to attack them appropriately, right? You got to disentangle the economic and the cultural. Let me see if I can answer your question. If you go back, this is why Wallace is so important. He is the spokesman of pride, right? He's the guy who says, the elites are looking down on you. And this is the beginning of a reformulation of what an elite is, away from, you know, the bankers and the railroad barons and towards Hollywood and the academy and pointy-headed intellectuals who can't park a bicycle straight. And that's why he's so important. I am, however, very reticent to make a simple structural argument, and I'm exhausted with simple structural arguments. I've had up to here with them, because they are completely inadequate to understand. So Judith Stein's argument is, in Pivotal Decade, a parallel book, is if we only had industrial policy, everything would have been fine. Give me three ifs, I can win any ball game. Yeah, if we had industrial policy, that'd be great. The question is, you have a structural crisis. How do you respond to it? What prevents a different response? You had a structural crisis in the 30s. You had a certain response to it. You have a different structural crisis in the 70s. Why does that create a specific response, right? And the response was a fragmentation, an ennui, a confusion, not a direct attack on the issues per se. There were voices putting a direct attack. But what I want to look at is why you have a structural crisis. And how, now, I don't want to look at why you have a structural crisis. I know why we have a structural crisis. I want to know what makes people respond in a specific way. And that's what I'm trying to get at. And that's why I do think culture is important and not just part of the problem. It's a cinch to say, oh, you know, stagflation came along, smashed the old liberalism, and out of that rose neoliberalism. And, you know, gosh. And this is the problem of the left, is that when it's working class agency all the way until something bad goes wrong, then it's the capitalist's fault. And that just doesn't make any sense to me. You know, you have to be able to account for the failure of agency as well, right? Otherwise, it's a disingenuous intellectual project.
Well, yeah, but surely the criticism of that is that maybe it isn't working class agency all the way. In other words, you don't have to accept that version of the lie. It's not obvious that it was like working class agency ever. Well, so there's a certain...
Really?
That's the problem of culture. That's the actual problem of culture.
Ever? I mean, wow.
Well, ever...
I'm usually the cynical one in the room.
In a useful way for our discussion.
Hey, yeah. Right, we'll take that.
Well, okay. Some other questions or angles here?
I'm trying to formulate this, but regarding the cultural history sections of the book, to what degree do you see the cultural expressions as sort of the barometer, sort of evidence of what is happening?
That's a great
point. What degree are they shaping the, you know, looking at Springsteen or Devo or Haggard, to what degree are they dictating the changes, or what degree are they responding to them?
Thanks for asking that. I think it's an important question. I don't even touch the impact question. I think in order to actually get an impact, you know, you'd need a level of study that is, I think it's probably beyond historians. I mean, I think you'd have to have polling groups watching the show. And actually, they've done that. I remember reading some stuff on Dallas where they actually post, you know, how do you feel about J.R. Ewing selling out his grandmother for a barrel of oil? So what I use that for is more of a barometer.
And but more than a barometer, I'm naive enough to think that artists and cultural creators have their ears tuned to sort of the cultural frequencies that in a way that we can't get directly all the time. So when Debo says, it's all collapsing around us, and you know, Akron's full of spuds, and there, you know, we're in the process of de-evolution. That's an interesting thing. They're listening to something. They're on to something, and we need to listen to that, I think. And so I'm using it more as a look at the set of ideas that are in circulation. I'm not saying, you know, oh, you know, when they were down in the steel mill listening to Jocko Homo, you know. Although you could make the case with Merle Haggard or maybe Springsteen. You know, some people who had these crazy smash hits that did create a cycle of reinforcement. But.
Would you want to follow up?
No, not just yet.
Okay. Yeah, sure. It's a great question.
Somebody else?
I have time. And I don't know exactly how I'm able to frame it as a question, but thinking about kind of, you know, these comparisons between the 30s and 40s and the 70s and sort of what's happening and what's changing, and while I won't make you give a structural explanation for it, but thinking about political structures and that, I mean, in the 30s and 40s, certainly labor and working class was important, but it was, you know, you can argue to degree, but it certainly was not a unified thing any more than it was in the 1970s. I mean, you know, with both. I mean, obviously that white skilled trade benefited the most from Democrats' embrace of it, but it was still a fractured movement, but that still was able to maybe not speak in a concerted voice, but was able to have political power. And so kind of what happened in the 70s were still a fractured entity. You know, working class is still lots of different race, gender, skills, all that stuff, but yet isn't able to, you know, how do the political structures, I guess, that labor is working in kind of, you know, increase its brittleness, I guess, to speak as a voice?
Yeah, no, that's good. I was kind of shocked when I got into the archives and realized how truly defensive the AFL-CIO was in the late 60s and early 70s, and how much they really felt under attack, not by business, but by counterculture and the new left and McGovern and whatever. And so I think one of the interesting things to look at is in the 30s and 40s, you're building a social movement out of very little after the 1920s, right? And so the CIO emerges from, you know, a whole host of things that we can debate. But by the time the 70s roll around, you have not only the sort of anti-institutionalism we've already talked about that emerges from the 60s, but you have this extraordinary head-in-the-sand approach of the existing unions. I mean, to all calls upon it, whether it's the women's movement, the civil rights movement, the calls to reform the Democratic Party after the seating crisis in 64 from the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, all this stuff, they fight off all comers. And so when you're talking about the brittleness of political structures, that's really it. These guys thought they won the game. And they were, you know, they thought it was over, but it, you know, I think I say something like they built a castle, but it was, you know, the foundation, I forget what the metaphor I used, but it was, you know, slipping out from underneath it as fast as they could build it. And politically, I spent so much time trying to figure out why they went out of their way to kill the McGovern insurgency instead of just sort of co-opting it or adapting it and things like that. And if you do a surface read on it, it would be because they're patriarchal, homophobic racists, and it's part of it. But if you really get below that surface, you find out, they owned the party in 1968 after the Kennedy and
McCarthy insurgencies. They ran the party for Humphrey. In 72, they thought they were the kings. And here McGovern came in undermined. They thought they actually had built a labor party out of the Democratic Party in their own image. And McGovern was undermining that. And it was actually about political power, I think. And they used a lot of their own gender and racial language to attack the McGovern insurgency that they should have been fighting off on their own, right? Saying that, you know, it's all kooks, communists, and queers over there, and you don't want anything to do with it. So this is a long-winded example to say that you had a set of institutions that were brittle, I think, and that fought very hard to maintain the political power they had, naively, rather than trying to be much more expansive and open to what could happen. So there's something about having the existing power of quote-unquote big labor pre-existing as you enter the crisis, especially in an era, and I agree with Leon, actually, that institutions are seen as the problem. Everything's inflationary. Unions are inflationary. The state is inflationary. And so how do you solve that problem? You get rid of the institutions, you know. And then when Gary Hart comes along, one of the great, you know, early neoliberal sort of Democrats, where does he come from? Well, he was the manager of the McGovern campaign, and he hated organized labor because they tried to kill him. It kind of makes sense.
Yeah.
So my question is kind of a big one, so I don't expect to do one. But I've been reading about the sort of decline of black power and that sort of stuff in the late 60s, early 70s. Uh-huh. And so I was struck by how what you talk about is some of the factors involved in the decline of the labor movement or labor unions and all that, as I see those same kinds of things coming up when I read about about black power, like violent repression, obviously. When I'm thinking about the relation between chapters 1 and 2, actually, the part about I forgot his name, but there was a labor union leader for the coal miners that was
Arnold Miller or Yablonsky.
Yeah, Yablonsky, and relating that somewhat to some of the things that you talk about in chapter 2. And so
right, exactly. Yeah, they're very, and that goes back to your question.
Yeah. So that also a sort of what's often referred to as co-optation, but also like just a kind of turn towards moving within, a system or being, you know, sort of a conservative turn that I think are all kind of related, I guess. But mm-hmm. then also the sort of cultural turn that is often kind of inward turning or misdirectional or something like that. And so I guess what I was wondering is like what relationship you see between those two things. Like how do you see like a decline in the
two
things being like the struggle for black equality as being like a subset of the sort of decline in, you know, labor union power or whatever class consciousness, or do you see those as working in some way? Because a lot of times you talk about, like, you know, the unions or white workers in any case having a sort of sense of being pitted against black workers.
Right.
And so I was just wondering, like, more how you relate those two elements to each other.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, here was all this energy coming out of the civil rights movement and beginning to merge into a more black power. Have you seen the Black Power mixtape yet? Yeah. And there was a great deal of debate within both the labor movement and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference and others. What do we do with that, and how do we connect it to labor? You know, Bayard Rustin's Protest of Politics tries to figure this out, and then he says we can't go it alone. You know, Stokely Carmichael, you can't. Black power is not enough. We really need to be in a coalition with unions and religious groups and the rest. And but at the same time that somebody like Rustin is making an argument, and Carmichael's trying to make an argument for a more autonomous sort of position, the black unions are having to form a caucus outside of the AFL-CIO, the Coalition for Black Trade Unionists, to try and change the culture of the labor movement. And I think, that's pretty problematic in terms of and it's the same with CLU, the Coalition of Labor Union Women, that the fact that, you know, I think these types of caucuses are probably well overdue, but that they're pushing against something that isn't really moving in their direction. And the one point that they seem to be able to talk together is full employment. And then Cleveland Robinson is in favor of it, Barry Rustin's in favor of it, George Meany's in favor, you know. So that becomes kind of a point of convenience. And the one thing I've never quite figured out is the degree to which anybody's really sincere about that as the one solution. They all say it is, but I can't figure out whether that's a political back-scratching kind of moment. And if it is, they put a lot of energy into it, and resources, but that does seem to be the one place where they come together. There are some interesting cartoons that the AFL-CIO put out against black power that you might want to look at about how it leads to white power, and it plays right into the Wallace business, and because they were quite afraid of it and really wanted to keep it within a coalition, but a coalition that really wasn't opening things up for not just African Americans but women as well. I'm quite sure I got you.
Yeah, we're getting. Who had it? Ian? Yeah, please.
Yeah. So the majority of the literature on contemporary American history since 1968 or 1972 or 1980, whatever. But its dominant theme is the right turn, explaining the right turn. And they might give different explanations of why the right turn happened, but most agree that it did. But then there's a small and growing literature that questions whether the right turn really happened or whether or not it's been tremendously exaggerated. And the best example I can think of is David Courtwright's, aptly titled, No Right Turn. And I don't know if I entirely buy it, but I mean, there is a case to be made that feminism, secularism, multiculturalism, et cetera, have not really retreated and in many ways advanced considerably, that the core of the New Deal and Great Society states are intact, and probably, I mean, Ron Paul would love if they disappeared, but there isn't great popular support for getting rid of Social Security or such, et cetera. So, your book rests on the foundation of the material facts of greater income inequality, greater wealth inequality, the relative, probably I should emphasize, relative decline of the political power of organized labor, and the retreat of the working class as being a term in political discourse. But is all of that synonymous with a right turn? And if it is, how do we explain these apparent persistent features of left liberalism, or even the triumph of left liberalism in some way?
Yeah, I know the argument. And I, to the degree to which most of that is based on defense, there's two dimensions. The economic stuff all seems defense to me. You know, we're going to put Social Security in a lockbox. We're going to try and protect collective bargaining from all these onslaughts. I'm not convinced. I think there has been a lot of advances, and this speaks a little bit to Mike Kazin's new book about the triumph of the left being more cultural than economic. I think there has continued to be kind of an expansion of cultural freedom, which is not antithetical at all to kind of a neoliberal economy. So, but I think in economics, it's kind of hard for me to imagine that. And, you know, when Clinton gets up and says the era of big government's over, you know, I don't know.
I think we're really about out of time. I got one last note. I just thought of something to throw out to you. How could we have had 2 hours of discussion of this period without any, I mean, there was mention of the Vietnam War, but no mention, I don't think, of the Cold War or communism. Is that just a post-1990 feature of our kind of understanding of recent history, or
in
terms of these developments?
Well, We're talking about the hard hat riot and stuff like that. I think those are definitely part and parcel of the Cold War. And I think that was really but yeah, and Reagan's sort of if you look at the polling on Reagan, actually, in his first term, it's largely the majority of people are against many of his economic policies, but in favor of his foreign policies.
But is it partly that the class that you, juggernaut coming out of, to the extent there was an alternative framework around the Democratic Party and the labor movement, was also wedded to the Cold War in important ways, and a foreign policy of American domination that was a little bit under, that was under attack, and that was really threatened by a variety of forces. And so, again, I guess I would raise the question whether it's a shifting nature of American nationalism and political formations as much as ideas about class.
Let's see. What's interesting is the degree in the mid-70s to which the whole Cold War consensus is rattled, and Reagan sort of reunites it. I mean, you have, we lose the Vietnam War, the Church Committee comes along, Frank Church leads this big investigation into the covert operations and the CIA, and we're all going to be better now, and then Carter makes human rights, not the Cold War, the centerpiece of his foreign policy, at least till Afghanistan, and then, that and detente and all this stuff. So there's also this odd interregnum in the 70s where the Cold War is less, I think, the dominant thing before it snaps back to, there's a bear in the woods.
It just occurred to me. Yeah. For all the rest of us, our next group session will occur during what should be a very spirited week with Nancy Fraser in mid-March, where she'll be doing a couple of presentations herself, but we'll be having one with her participation as well in the middle of her 3-day visit. So stay tuned for the specific announcements. But Jeff, thanks so much.
Thank you for having me.
Ha 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 ha.